Good afternoon and welcome to the Medium and Heavy Duty Electric Operations webinar presented in partnership with South Shore Clean Cities, Chicago Area Clean Cities, and Wisconsin Clean Cities for the first installment in the winter webinar series. My name is Ryan Lisek, Project Manager for South Shore Clean Cities, and I'd like to thank everyone for attending today and a special thank you to all of our speakers. Just a reminder, all attendees are on listen-only mode, and today's webinar will be recorded and shared on all three coalitions' websites, respectively. If you have any questions throughout the presentation, please type them in the chat box in the panel on the side of your screen. If you have questions for a specific speaker, please address them accordingly. We will be monitoring these questions throughout the webinar and will address them as we are able to. All right, I would like to introduce our speakers for today. First up, we're going to have Anthony Maietta. He is the Midwest Clean Diesel Initiative Coordinator for the U.S. EPA Region 5, who will give us more information on the agency's DARA programs available in Indiana, Illinois, and Wisconsin. After we have Mr. Maietta talking, we will move to the roundtable discussion with the following folks to discuss a variety of electric options available for your fleets. First, we have Michael Morton, General Manager for Alta Equipment Company. Then we have Kurt Nikens. He is the President and Chief Technology Officer for Orange EV. Then we have Ryan Zick. He is the Vice President of Sales for ROUSH CleanTech. And then rounding it all up, we have Jamie Bannerman. He is the Trackmobile Sales Specialist for Voss Equipment. Thank you all again for participating in this webinar. We really appreciate it. But before we hand over the virtual podium to Mr. Maietta, I'd like to say a few things about the Clean Cities Partnership. South Shore Clean City, Chicago Area Clean Cities, and Wisconsin Clean Cities are nonprofit coalitions that have partnered together over the years to provide innovative and sustainable practices to our member fleets. Our coalitions also partner together with our member fleets to reduce environmental impact, improve energy security, and foster economic initiatives through the adoption of domestic alternative fuels and advanced vehicle technologies while creating policy that reduce petroleum usage. The coalitions also partner together on other educational opportunities, such as this webinar, to help spread awareness and build partnerships that lead to funding opportunities that reduce transportation-related emissions. The Clean Cities programs work with our members to provide grant and funding opportunities while building relationships with our stakeholders. The successes that we are able to achieve come from working with incredible leaders and experts within the transportation industry, including the ones who are participating today. We are constantly looking at the big picture in order to make the biggest impact in each state in reducing emissions and our dependence on imported oil. Several projects that Chicago Area Clean Cities, South Shore Clean Cities, and Wisconsin Clean Cities are involved in include the Michigan to Montana I-94 Clean Corridor Project, also known as M2M. This project seeks to ensure a 1,500-mile span on Interstate 94, starting from Port Huron, Michigan, to Billings, Montana, that will have adequate fueling sites to serve alternative fuel and electric vehicle driver needs. The vehicle charging innovations for multi-unit dwelling project, which engages stakeholders to document barriers to multi-unit and residential curbside charging stations and demonstrate innovative technologies that address these barriers. The Diesel Emission Reduction Act and the Midwest Clean Diesel Initiative, which Mr. Maietta will discuss in more detail shortly. And finally, the Volkswagen settlement programs, where we have been able to fund transformational projects that reduce diesel emissions. As you see on the slide here, we have the experience and the proven record that can lead to success for every one of your projects. Partner with the winning team. If you're looking for ways to improve your fleet's performance or need assistance, please contact one of our coalitions that are listed here, and we will be happy to assist you. Once again, just as a reminder, if you have any questions throughout this webinar, please type them into the box on your screen, and we'll address those later in the webinar. Without further ado, I now like to introduce our first speaker, Mr. Anthony Maietta, who is the Midwest Clean Diesel Initiative Coordinator for the US EPA Region 5. Tony, go ahead when you're ready, sir.
Cool. Thank you, Ryan. And thank you for allowing me to speak to everybody today. I really do have just a few quick slides to explain our program, how it fits into the Clean Cities partnerships, kind of make the link between the Clean Cities EPA partnerships and the Midwest Clean Diesel Initiative. And, I believe that tomorrow we actually are expected to open our request for applications for 2021 funding through this program. And I'm going to kind of briefly, hopefully, touch on, the opportunities for diesel to electric vehicle replacements. And in certain cases, diesel to electric engine powertrain replacements, too. So there are opportunities everywhere. What I want you to take away from what I'm about to explain is truly the link at the end. There's going to be links to the partners' sites and links to our funding websites. That's what I really want you guys to write down if you do write down anything today. So just a quick overview of why this program exists. So EPA has been created by Congress, and we have broad powers to regulate 6 criteria pollutants that are outlined in the Clean Air Act. And I highlight in red 2 of them, which are the drivers for our clean diesel program. And it's ozone and particulate matter. Those are emissions that come out of the tailpipes of vehicles, not ozone directly. Diesel vehicles, cars, combustion processes emit chemicals that will form ozone in the air. But it is ozone itself that is harmful to the human body and the environment. It kind of like gives your lungs sort of like a sunburn. It can exacerbate existing, breathing problems and possibly cause ones too. And for particulate matter, it's sort of soot, and it's dark. You see it less and less. Now you will see it on diesel vehicles that are very old or diesel vehicles that are improperly maintained. Very few and far between should you ever see now black puffs of smoke coming out of diesel engines. But if you do see that black puff of smoke, that's particulate matter primarily. It is made up of many different things, but they have the same property. They're very small. They're 2.5 microns in diameter or less. They get very deep into your lungs when you breathe them in. It could be heavy metals. It could be random, organic compounds. That's the thing, is that you don't know what's really in it, but you breathe it very deep into your lungs because they're so small. And because these pollutants are out there, EPA has, again, through the Clean Air Act, broad authority to regulate those 6 pollutants. And so that's where you're seeing, fuel standards for cars, for folks in the Chicago area like myself. Every few years you have to go get your vehicle emission tested, which nowadays, involves plugging it in. There are engine standards. So if you buy a certain model year vehicle, or for non-road diesel engines, if you have a certain tier that the vehicle, the equipment meets, those standards are set by EPA through the Clean Air Act. But today, what I'm also here to talk about is the voluntary approaches that we have. And that is the National Clean Diesel Campaign, which administers Diesel Emission Reduction Act funds. And that National Clean Diesel Campaign is the nationwide, program for this. And in EPA Region 5, where I work out of Chicago, is the headquarters building for that. So we work with the states of Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, Illinois, Indiana, and Ohio. And our 6 state coalition and a few states that we partner with outside of that too is called the Midwest Clean Diesel Initiative. And our partners today are, among our partners are the 3 clean cities groups that, put together this presentation. So again, thank you so much for, allowing me to kind of get this info out there. The Diesel Emission Reduction Act, it provides funding on a competitive basis to eligible entities you know, and this is what Congress wrote in this legislation. It's basically meant to turn over the existing diesel fleet. Okay. And so our funding, and again, like I sort of said in the beginning, you can't just go and buy a new diesel engine if you didn't own one before, or buy a new electric vehicle or piece of equipment if you didn't have a diesel engine of heavy or medium duty size to begin with, because that's, you know, in the Energy Policy Act of 2005, this is what was outlined there. And these funds can only be used to buy an EPA or CARB certified engine or a verified technology, so like a retrofit device. We split our money 30-70, so 30% of the funding that we get, and we believe for 2021, the national funding is about $90 million. We recertify older funds, so it'll be a little bit larger than that, but 30% of that funding goes directly to states, and they can deny it if they don't want the funding. We provide an incentive, so they get a little bit of extra funding if they match what we give them. And then 70% of that goes into the request for applications that is projected to open tomorrow, which is a competitive grant program. There are tribal RFAs that are out there. I don't unfortunately know when the next tribal one will be, but there will be one this year. And then we have rebate programs like you know, the school bus rebate program that opens at the end of every September, so like September 30th, the beginning of each fiscal year. So October 1st, that program should be open. I think we announced it the day before. But if we don't, you know, check early October, and schools can apply directly for those rebates. And again, on the right-hand side, keep in mind who can apply: a regional, state, local, tribal, or port agency with jurisdiction over transportation or air quality, nonprofit organizations such as the Clean Cities organizations, institutions that represent or provide pollution reduction or educational services to people, organizations that operate diesel fleets, or that have as their principal purpose promotion of transportation or air quality. So unfortunately, a private company can't apply on its own. However, what we see is private companies will partner with these partner organizations, and with the federal funding that's going to open up tomorrow, primarily what we see is, you know, you'll see a nonprofit group partner with several different private companies for a very large application. And so that's what we encourage folks to do, because that maximizes, you know, you have one group that just kind of deals with like the paperwork and like the funding transfer and the documentation information. And then you have all the fleets that take on the actions. What's eligible? A whole lot. Medium and heavy duty diesel engines, basically, can include, not limited to, buses, class 5 to 8 heavy duty highway vehicles, marine engines, marine vessels, locomotive engines, non-road engines equipment, you know, construction, cargo handling, ag, mining, energy production. So there's a whole wide swath of what can be funded. EPA has, Region 5 have funded pretty much everything in the past that we continue to. I do want to say that the focus of our funding is primarily on areas that have, you know, that don't meet our air quality standards. Good news is that fewer of these areas exist. You know, it's not that you have to be, like, for me in Chicago, it would be the Chicago metropolitan area. So that is, you know, Chicago, Northwest Indiana, a little bit into Wisconsin. But it doesn't mean you can't apply if you're outside those areas. It just means as a priority area, you'll get a little bit more points on your application. We have priority for, so basically you want to reduce as much as possible people's exposure to diesel emissions. And so that'll either be buying a new diesel engine, buying a new alternatively fueled engine vehicle, or maybe buying an electric vehicle, which is, you know, today's conversation. And I'm going to go to the next slide here. So I want to note that this was last year's funding percentages. We don't believe they're going to change much, if at all. They don't tend to change year by year. So this is likely what we'll see tomorrow when it opens. And I underlined the electric options here. And to give you a sense, we promote cleaner is better. And if you replace the diesel engine with an electric vehicle or piece of equipment, and you're going from however many diesel, you know, however many tons per year, or pounds, grams per year of diesel emissions to zero, because the electric piece of equipment doesn't have a diesel engine at all. So you can see that for the first category, vehicle equipment replacement, 25% if you're just buying a new diesel, 35% if you're going to get something that's a little bit cleaner, like the low NOx standards, 45% if you're going to, so 45% of the cost of the new vehicle, EPA will provide if you are selected through an application to replace your old diesel vehicle or piece of equipment with an electric one. I do also have to explain that in this program, the old piece of equipment or vehicle has to be destroyed because it's a turnover program. They said make it cleaner and accelerate that. So that's what this program does. So if you have to drill a hole in the old engine so it can't be used again, and then you have to cut the old chassis so that it can't be used as an old vehicle for school buses and things like that, the seats, any other sort of upfit stuff for construction equipment that can be saved. It's not, those don't produce emissions. It's the engine and the chassis as a vehicle or piece of equipment that does. So keeping that in mind. And here's some important information, the partnerships. And so, again, we have six different states that we partner with our state air agencies primarily. We give directly 30% of that funding goes to them. But to compete this money out, we want to get the word out as much as possible. So in each of the states, you can see that, you're going to have each of the Clean Cities web pages, but also the state air agencies that are involved with spending EPA and sometimes the Volkswagen settlement funding too, because that's a separate program that, it was funding that is given to states because EPA busted Volkswagen for cheating on the Clean Air Act with, the emissions of their diesel passenger vehicles. So states have the funds. Now we don't touch them. States are, that's why I put those web links there, because EPA doesn't run that funding cycle now. It's all in the state's hands. But the skeleton of how they, the instructions for how to do that was written out by EPA when this program started. So that's, you'll see those links there. There's a lot of money in the state programs. Depending on what they offer, you may or may not be able to apply for their funding. States get to decide what they want to fund. But largely, they do tend to dump some of their money into their EPA programs to kind of make that pot of money a little bit larger. So you'll see that sometimes too. And then I think this is my last slide. Yep, these are the EPA clean diesel programs. Just overall links, that epa.gov/DIRA in the upper left corner, that's the one you should check tomorrow, which we believe will open at some point for the 2021 RFA. And that'll be open, I believe, for 45 days. There will be webinars that are going to be run. All that information will be on that main page to see some of the focus of what our work, some of our focus areas, the ports initiative, in Northwest Indiana and Chicago, Milwaukee area too. Ports and goods movement, so things that come in on rail, things that may come in off the water, the vehicles and drayage equipment that just, they stay in the metropolitan area and go back and forth between these areas of high diesel activity. It says ports, but it's ports and goods movement. And we highlight the ends goods movement portion in our region very strongly, and so do our partners. So, take a look at that. And then Smartway Transport on the bottom right is a voluntary program for if you have a fleet and you want to kind of benchmark your environmental performance and say, hey, we'll do these things in the future. You can see how much money you might save on not spending diesel fuel and also how much pollution you'll reduce as well. And then if you have any other questions about anything I talked about, feel free to give me a call or an email. Probably an email. I'll answer that, more promptly. So thank you very much for letting me speak today. And happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Tony, for that great presentation and very informative.
Thank you.
I'd like to now move to the roundtable discussion and welcome our other speakers. Kind of feel like the 96 Bulls announcing the players coming onto the floor here. So first off, we have Mike Morton. He is the general manager with Alta Equipment. Alta Equipment is a leading industrial and construction equipment company, and Mr. Morton is an expert in the material handling equipment and is going to be discussing today about the all-electric Centerbogen material handling equipment. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Morton. Next, we have Kurt Nikens. He is the president and chief technology officer with Orange EV. Orange EV is the leader in electric terminal trucks with fleet deployments across the country. Mr. Neutgens is an expert in the electric vehicle industry and without a doubt, one of the most intelligent people I have had the pleasure of meeting. Next, we have Jamie Bannerman. Jamie is the track mobile sales specialist with Voss Equipment. Voss Equipment is a leader rail car handling equipment dealer. Jamie is going to be talking today about their zero emission rail car movers, their Zephyrs, excuse me. Finally, we have Mr. Ryan Zick. He is the Vice President of Sales with ROUSH CleanTech. ROUSH CleanTech is the leading energy solutions from a Bluebird school buses down to Ford cutaways and everything in between. Mr. Zick will be discussing ROUSH's latest endeavors in the all-electric F-650. Thank you for joining us today, gentlemen. I see that all your webcams are on. Go ahead and unmute yourselves as well. And we're going to get right into the round table questions. So first off, this question is directed at Kurt. Kurt, in the terminal truck industry, what's the main factor that fleets are looking for when moving to electric terminal trucks? Is it fuel cost savings, environmental benefits, operational cost savings, diesel emission control benefits?
Yeah, that's a great question, Ryan. And thank you very much for including me and Orange in the amongst all these great speakers within the presentation. Thank you very much. To answer the question, we see some of all of those. I mean, many of our customers have different reasons. The hard savings drives a lot of discussion. That's several of the comments or the categories you mentioned. You know, the fuel cost savings, the operational cost savings, the diesel emission control benefits, and that really comes down to a savings in my mind, which is separate than the emissions themselves. But those can all be lumped together in kind of a total cost of ownership discussion. Our trucks, because they're used so much and because they're so efficient, can save up to $20,000 per year per truck for a single shift operation. Now, our trucks can go three shift operation. We have many vehicles out there with customers doing 24/7 operation, and those trucks can save up to $60,000 per year just in hard fuel and maintenance savings. In addition, there's to that $60,000 per year, there's some soft savings there also. Things like you're not breathing those particulates or the NOx that we talked about earlier in the presentation that Tony did. We have a higher driver retention because the trucks are smoother and quiet and there's not vibrating all the time and you're not sitting in a 300-degree cabin. Or I'm sorry, a cabin that has a 300-degree motor underneath you. And then, you know, fueling logistics and hazmat issues are also improved. Others buy on just, you know, the environmental benefits. And that's really part of our mission. And that is why we're in business, is to change that situation in the world. And so a lot of our customers buy for that reason. And then there's additional reasons. We have significant improvements in uptime versus any diesels out there. Our safety is better with almost a 50% reduction in stopping distance. So that's a significant safety benefit. And then our customers tell us we have better service because we come to you service situation where we have mobile service coming to the customer and correcting these really mission critical vehicles on the spot and getting them back up and running or even coming out and just doing the maintenance. So lots of different reasons, you know, definitely the hard savings is one of the bigger ones.
Terrific. Absolutely. That is very important when customer service is pertinent when you have switching to a new technology, new fuel, new truck. So absolutely. This next question is directed towards Mr. Morton. Mike, can you talk about the electric Sennenbogen material handling equipment and its origin?
Oh, absolutely. And thank you, Ryan. Good afternoon, everyone. You know, so I'll briefly talk about Sennebogen and a little bit about Alta. You know, here's my slide presentation. So this is the electric Sennebogen. And as you can tell, it's an ugly color. It's green, but it reflects their commitment to the environment. Think of an excavator, which is kind of what the Sennebogen is. And rather than being a digger, it's a lifter. They're typically between 50,000 pounds and 250,000 pounds. Although some of the equilibrium cranes that they use in the ports can weigh up to 750,000 pounds. So it's a big stout machine. They're headquartered in Straubing, Germany. They have North American facilities in Charlotte, and they're the leading manufacturer of global material handlers and have been for 65 years. In North America, they're quickly becoming the leading provider of specialized equipment. They do other things with cranes and other lifting apparatuses, but really in North America, their commitment is to material handling. Their biggest markets are in recycling, which is again the emphasis on the green color, scrapyards, demolition. They're now making a big push with barge and port applications, and we'll talk about that more. Steel mills, transfer stations in waste facility places, and quite frankly, recently is in the tree care industry. Alta Equipment is one of their dealers. We have a footprint in Florida, Michigan, Illinois, and Indiana, and we're proud to represent the product. The Sennebogen has been powering the material handlers in both Europe and North America for over 20 years, so they're not new to the game. They're very skilled and experienced in the process. Green efficiency is kind of what they call one of their core principles. An example of this was with the introduction of electric drive material handler in a transfer station processing scrap. Waste. The customer wanted to reduce the environmental impact of their waste management activities. They also needed a machine that could work indoors, which is very difficult for a typical construction piece of equipment, with very low ceiling heights, but also have the ability to move around. And they found the solution for what was the smallest model, which is the 50,000 pound machine, which is a 821 electric. And they found that it reduces emissions of nitrogen oxides and fine dust particles, and also saves on fuel and operating cost. So it required less maintenance and delivered a longer service life for the customer. Another one that we're really excited about and been working with Ryan on is an important stevedoring application. They're looking for a large electric material handler specifically for this. The company is looking for it for a number of reasons, but to keep the environment healthy and to save on fuel costs. And the customer once said to me, you know, once electric, always electric. They're excited about the electric material handler because it's completely emissions free and ultimately will save them money, as well as its environmentally sound practices will promote goodwill in the community, which no one could underestimate in this environment. And because it's based over, in this case, fresh water, everyone's very sensitive to environmental contaminations. So with the electric Sennebogen, not only the zero emissions, but the zero chance of fuel leaks and the administrative nightmare that goes along with any kind of environmental problem. So it's a really neat product. We're proud to represent it. And again, it's nice to be a steward to the environment, while also being really a better mousetrap for the industries that the markets that they represent. So that, in a nutshell, Ryan, is who Sennebogen is. Alta is just the heavy equipment distributor in the Midwest, in the Southeast, and again it's a very important line for our company. So thank you. And again, anyone during the course of the presentation have any questions, just fire away.
Thank you, Mike. This next question is directed over at Jamie. Jamie, how did Voss Equipment get involved with the Zephyr electric railcar mover?
Yes, thank you, and thanks for having me. My name is Jamie. Like I mentioned, I work for the Voss Equipment. We are the local track mobile dealer as well as Zephyr dealer. Not only are we a full-line material handling company, but we are your one-stop shop for all your railcar moving needs within a plant. So just to give you a little history, back in the early 80s, Voss Equipment became the track mobile dealer for the Illinois and Northwest Indiana areas. What are track mobiles? Track mobiles, they are diesel powered bimodal railcar shunters. Bottom line is they move railcars within a plant once the class one railroad drops off a string of cars. So at that point, the customer has two options. You can do B, you can wait for the class one railroad to come back out with their locomotive to index the cars within the plant, or you can go with the better option, option A, which could be an electric powered Zephyr railcar shunter. Their own employees can actually physically move the cars within the plant to unload that raw material or push that finished product off to the side. But since 1981, Voss Equipment has sold approximately around 2,000 units here in the Illinois and Northwest Indiana area, being via both the diesel equipment as well as electric. But to answer your question, back in 2018, Trackmobile merged with its sister company, Zephyr. Zephyr, again, this is the electric battery-powered railcar mover. The reason for the merger between the two, between Zephyr and Trackmobile, it falls under the Marmon Group. Unfortunately, we had the Berkshire Hathaway family there, and we like to think Warren Buffett's a pretty smart guy, and I think we're in pretty good hands there when it comes down to the railcar moving needs. But if you're looking for just a good, cost-effective, low-maintenance, low-admissions machine that has the same pushing and pulling capabilities as a diesel, we think that the Zephyr, the electric model, would be a perfect option for you.
Good. Thank you, sir. This next question is directed over at Ryan Zick. Ryan, can you talk a little bit about the electric battery performance in the medium duty trucks that are offered from ROUSH?
Yeah, thanks Ryan, and thanks for having ROUSH CleanTech be a part of this today. So I think when we look at medium duty, that's really a space that ROUSH CleanTech's been in for the past 10 or 12 years, most notably in propane, auto gas, and now getting into battery electric vehicles. And if we take a step back even from ROUSH CleanTech and we just look at what battery electric is good at and what those medium duty customers are looking for, in several of their different vocations, we really see a really good fit between EV technology. So, you know, what does EV do for a customer, right? It reduces the complexity of the powertrain, right? Fewer moving pieces, less maintenance. What does the medium duty customer do on a day-to-day basis, right? They do a lot of lower speed operation, at least stop and start is very common. A lot of key on and key offs throughout the day, which is pretty hard on a traditional powertrain, especially a diesel powertrain, which really doesn't like that high idle application. When you flip over to EV, really the conversation changes and the vehicle's impervious to that long idle or stop and go or key off and key on, right? So it really makes this great ideal fit between the technology and what the customer wants to do. The other things we look at too, that, you know, the shortcomings of EV today, which could be some of the range that we talk about, right? We can get more range, but at a much higher cost. But we see in a lot of medium duty applications, we don't necessarily need a tremendous amount of range to do the job. You know, when we talk to some of these vocations, 60 miles a day can cover a lot of the routes that they do. And with that, a pretty reasonable battery pack is able to get you and do the job without getting too much cost involved in the product. So just from a whole, it's a really good fit from what the vehicles are doing to what the customer expectation is. And we're actually able to reduce their cost per mile by doing that, by switching over to battery electric technology, and also reduce their maintenance and increase the uptime that they can experience with the vehicle. So overall, we're finding a good fit. And I think what we're seeing too is the demand is basically echoing that, right? So we see the demand from the customers come through, and now we're seeing big OEMs starting to get on board with it. So maybe some of you saw the announcement earlier this week, GM announcing an EV van that is going to serve the medium duty segment. And then also Ford saying that they're going to have an OE offering of the Transit also to serve the same segment. So we're seeing the demand, the OEs even are responding to it. And what we're looking for at Roush CleanTech is, where is that perfect fit where maybe the OEs aren't going to support the platform, but it's still a staple of the medium duty industry, and we could have a really big impact with battery electric technology.
Thank you, very interesting. Thanks for covering all the bases there. This next question is directed at Mr. Maietta. Tony, when comparing diesel emission reduction projects, as you've just touched based on, compared to the different fuel options that are available, how does electric score?
You know, so what we look at primarily is what that vehicle that started off was doing. You know, it's not that you're saying, hey, I want to replace it to an electric versus replace it to a diesel. It's that you're saying, I have this vehicle that I want to clean up and take this action for. You know, clearly we offer a higher percentage of funding for an electric replacement. You know, frankly, it does cost a little more in certain cases. We do fund a bunch of electric stuff. Lately, we've seen a lot of, you know, the shorter, you know, it's where it makes sense to do it. You know, like Ryan was just talking about, we see a lot of yard equipment. We see electrified cranes because there's like a long plug that kind of, you know, cable that kind of goes to the thing. We're seeing school buses. We're seeing transit buses. Like, we've given grants to CTA to do six, I think, maybe seven. I think it's six of them. You know, so we're seeing it in more and more applications these days. What I'm thinking about this group and looking at the types of equipment that you're seeing here, you know, I have to emphasize it, it's the role that the vehicle the original vehicle is doing. And what you're doing is just kind of replacing that, so you're making that cleaner. And it's the impact that that vehicle or piece of equipment has. So if it's at a yard that's doing work all day and it's near a neighborhood, whether or not that's in, you know, a large urban area like Chicago or a smaller urban area or a smaller metropolitan, you know, town. But if there's people nearby and there's a bunch of engines that are running all day and they're old, and, you know, you want to make the case to say, hey, for the maintenance reasons, for the fuel saving reasons, for the cost reasons, for the emission reduction reasons, plus you can get a grant for it, you know what I mean? That's more what we look at as opposed to whether or not. And I think, you know, if there is a review of that, that will take place largely after we've selected everything. And we're looking about how much money we have to give out versus how much we've selected, kind of thing. You know, if that comes into play. And if that does come into play, that's far above my pay grade, and, you know, it's not something, you know, I look at. So I hope that answers the question.
Oh, you're perfect. Yeah, just generally speaking, thank you very much. Yeah. I'm going to kick it back to Mr. Morton. What are the advantages and savings of using electric material handlers comparative to diesel?
Oh, good question. I was thinking about this and said, okay, well, let me give the top five reasons. And then I got to number 10. And I said, well, I'll just start rattling them all off, because I think what's happening is that there's more reasons to, you know, go with green technology nowadays. So, I mean, I'll start with the one thing. It's always a monetary thing with our customers, right? So can you make sense of this? Because there, in many cases, there's infrastructure costs that bolt onto the acquisition of the piece of equipment itself. But, you know, when you tell them that there's going to be a higher retention value of the machine because you're going to get longer hydraulic component life, it perks their ears. I got a customer that just exceeded 100,000 running hours or operating hours on a machine, when you're looking at a comparable diesel machine of 30,000 before you have to, you know, either rebuild it or retire it. I mean, that's phenomenal. That's the equivalent of on a double shift, 20 years of a useful life machine. You're going to get up to 50% reduction of operating cost. And so when you start adding that up, the machine ultimately will pay for itself. You got to increase uptime because you're extending your maintenance intervals on it. You don't have to do 250-hour PMs because there are no PMs when engine PMs. You know, you're going to reduce the maintenance costs because no need for fuel, no need for filters, no need for engine oil. The machine is always ready for use, right? So there's no downtime for fuel. You don't have to store fuel. So you get in each morning and go to work. Obviously, the thing that gets everyone excited is it's extremely environmentally friendly, completely emissions free, no exhaust fumes. With that comes safety features. And I think it was mentioned prior before is that you increase the operator comfort due to working in a vibration-free mechanism or a vehicle. And not only that, you know, as we all notice on cars that pull up that are electric, you can't hear them, right? So you now have a much safer situation for the operator because of the low noise emitted by the machine. Again, no spills, etc. So, you know, talking about the infrastructure costs, you know, we've got to run power to it. So in the case when I was talking about the guy that was working the machine in the transfer station, he was doing that with a ceiling-mounted electrical cable. You could use conductor bars, cable carriers, cable reels. The guy that we're talking about doing it on a port application is going to look at a trenching and running a cable reel. But the numbers are really what turns the customer's head. When you start looking at a typical operating cost for a diesel machine, so you got the estimated repair cost for a diesel machine, the maintenance cost for a diesel machine, and the actual fuel cost for diesel. And you compare that to the repair cost to electric, the maintenance cost for electric, and the electrical cost. And typically, you're saving somewhere in the neighborhoods on a big machine, $40,000, $50,000 a year. You start adding that up again over a 20-year period of time. And it virtually, as I said before, it will pay for the cost of the machine. So killing two birds with one stone, right? You're being a good steward to the environment. You're not losing production, you're gaining production, and you're doing it with cost savings to the customer. So it's a win-win-win for the product.
Terrific. Thank you. Very good answers. Next question is for, yeah, go ahead.
You spoke about infrastructure for the DERA grants. You know, if it's a vehicle or piece of equipment like a cable plugged in crane at a dock or something, that cabling can be part of the application, you know, part of that funding. You can't, like, if you're extending it off property, you need to put transformers and whatnot in, like, that's, you know, outside the bounds of what can be funded. But if you're saying, you know, if you purchase like a couple trucks or a truck and you don't have a charger for them, you know, that charger can be incorporated into the cost because that's, you know, you need to have to run it. The electrical cost to charge it, like paying the electrical bill, is not eligible. But in certain cases, some of that infrastructure can be put into the cost of the, you know, application and the funding for that percentage.
Yeah, and that's, you know, listen, that's why I got Ryan. I mean, the partnership between the companies sponsoring this webinar are huge and make a lot of this possible. So, you know, without, you know, blowing smoke, thank you, Ryan, because he's connected to my hip on these type of situations. So, you're absolutely right. And that's a good thing for the customer to understand that he can roll some of these costs into the project.
Absolutely. Thanks for elaborating on that to the both of you as well, because that is an important cost factor here when we're looking at the overall implementations of these types of equipment. The next question is going to be directed back at Kurt. Kurt, during the beautiful Midwest winters that we experience here with that four-letter word snow, What is Orange EV's uptime performance based on an industry that must maintain efficient logistics and must be ready to go at the drop of a hat?
Yeah, well, you know, it's a good question. And, you know, we're excited about the fact that our trucks are showing excellent uptime, exceeding the diesels that they're replacing. And part of that's, like Michael discussed, because we have fewer things to do for maintenance and also repair. You know, we charge our trucks, or our customers charge our trucks, when the driver is on break. So we don't have any downtime to charge the truck. We provide our own charging solutions. We provide different solutions for those customers, depending on their operation. So we go in, we work with the customers and say, if you have an 8-hour operation and, you know, the truck's sitting for the other 16 hours, we're not going to put in a high charge rate facility or a product. When we provide the charges along with the trucks. But if you have a 24/7 operation, we can charge in 2 hours. And so we can charge within the half hour that the 15 minute breaks that the operator's on break. So in the winters, you know, that time, the amount of energy use is a little bit more. So we have heaters in their battery packs. We have heaters obviously for in the cabin for the customer. One of the nice things about electric heat is it's instant on. You don't wait for the engine to warm up over 20 minutes or whatever it's going to be. You turn it on and, you know, 30 seconds later, you can feel that. So, but the uptime is really not dependent on the temperature. We've got over 700,000 hours of time on our fleet. We've got telematics in all our trucks, so we can tell exactly when they've been on and off and where they are. And so 700,000 hours on our fleet. And our first truck was sold, our first production truck was sold to DHL in Chicago way back in 2015. That truck is still running today, along with trucks in Buffalo, New York with the snow, and Michigan and Minneapolis, Minnesota. Okay, so I'm from Minnesota. Everyone else thinks it's cold. When you go to Minnesota, you realize what cold really is. So, you know, we're seeing minus 40 degrees C or NF. It's the same minus 40. They cross at that point. So we see those temperatures and we're still running and our customers are happy. And so it is not an uptime issue in the cold. One of the neat things I'll share with you is, you know, this is not in the cold, but it's indicative of our uptime. And it's from Bolthouse Farms. They did a press release. The state of California asked them to do a webinar like this. We didn't even know about it. And they put together a presentation. They did a press release on the work they had done. And I bring this up because it's independent, right? It's not us saying, hey, we're great, everything's terrific. It's our customer saying that. And they bought two of our trucks back in 2017. And they bought a diesel truck at the same time, brand new one, and said, hey, let's compare these over a 2-year study. And so that's what they did. And they ran the trucks for 2 years in their operations doing carrot juice. And they wash them down every day with the carrot juice. And they go to the washer for the carrots. And so we're talking about a significant amount of water comes on these trucks, you know, 100 times a day. Now, I don't know if that's really 100, but multiple times a day, let me put it that way. What they found was over a 2-year period, our trucks had 25% of the downtime of the brand new diesels. Now, these are trucks we built back in 2017. Our trucks are much better today than they were back then. We were at 25% of the downtime versus the diesels back then. And the cost per hour that they ran. Now, this doesn't include the savings they had for fuel. This was maintenance and repair costs. For our trucks, it was 78 cents. For the diesels, it was $3.93 an hour. So it's over a $3 per hour savings. So this is a press release. You can go out and look at for Nick Chase press release from Bolthouse Farms. This isn't us talking or bringing numbers together. This is them putting something out on the web. So, you know, we're really proud of that, but I'm sure everyone on this board has examples that are near to those numbers or even better. You know, our application, we feel, is really a perfect application for electric. Because, as mentioned earlier, you have got start and stop. Diesels don't do that very well. You've got lots of idle. Diesels don't do that very well. The emissions equipment on a diesel and a yard truck doesn't work because the regen of the catalyst doesn't work because you never get up to speed. So we've picked, a great first application for our technology. And it really shows in that uptime. It shows in the ability for the customers to really just make hay with our trucks.
Absolutely. That speaks volumes when your customer is telling you these metrics.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Just a reminder to everyone that's on the webinar, please put in your questions directed to the different speakers that we have here. We're going to be addressing those soon. Next question I have is for Mr. Zick. Mr. Zick, why is it so important for your company to tap into the last mile delivery services kind of industry?
Well, I think probably everybody here on the panel has something in common, which would be at some point this week, Amazon's going to deliver something to each of our houses, probably some more than others, but that's that last mile delivery that we're talking about. And with last mile, you see, especially during the past, you know, year, we've seen just the growth of it, right? More and more packages are being delivered that way. More and more people are doing online shopping. So the growth in that segment's really big. And it also has a really favorable layout and model for EVs. So typically what we call a hub and spoke design. So those trucks, whether we're talking about step vans or other types of delivery vehicles in the medium duty segment, they're going to be loaded up with all of their cargo to go out for deliveries. And they're usually going to have a designated area that they go out and serve, typically also in neighborhoods, which also is very important when you're considering reducing emissions and noise as those companies are operating right here, you know, on our city streets and then also in neighborhoods and other places like that in residential areas. So there's an initiative from those companies to focus on that. The environmental side of it, which jives really well with battery electric and zero emissions, the reduced noise, which a few of the other panelists have brought in, not only from the standpoint of the driver, but also the standpoint of the community, not really hearing that loud truck rattle down the subdivision, so to speak. So it's a great fit, but that hub and spoke fits really well for EV too, because we talked before about one of the limitations of electric being, you know, the range that the overall vehicle can do. It can't compete with a diesel vehicle, right? Not today. But it doesn't have to in these models. So it's a really great fit to be able to do everything. And getting back to what Tony said, everything that vehicle does today can be done with the EV version of it. So that traditional fuel vehicle is not gonna be able to do anything more because it's limited by the duty cycle and how many packages that vehicle could go out and deliver on one route. So that's really where we're focusing there. And it just seems to be a great fit with that medium duty segment. So for us, class 4 through 7 is really ideal for that. And the Ford platforms that we operate on, we really see the step van being the backbone of that, along with the F-650, which would be a traditional box truck, really dominating the parcel and last mile delivery industry.
Absolutely. Sounds like the perfect operation for the technology. This last question before we get into attendee questions, Jamie. You know, with you're in the rail car mover, you're moving sometimes hundreds of tons. How does the electric versions of the rail car movers make sense for the freight switcher locomotive industry?
The biggest thing we see is the cost of ownership. The cost of ownership is greatly great. You know, we did a case study not too long ago regarding an old switching locomotives. These are like 1940s, 1950s, you know, Plymouth switching locomotives, and they're burning approximately 10 gallons an hour. And these old, you know, 70-year-old switching locomotives, they have to be ran here in the Midwest for 24 hours a day, especially during the winter months. Quick math is, you know, 10 gallons an hour, 24 hours a day, you're burning around 240 gallons of diesel fuel every day. And at $2 an hour, you're almost, you know, $480. The cost savings on the fuel, it's around $175,000, give or take, on fuel consumption on an old switching locomotive versus an alternative being on the electric railcar moving side. the admissions, the admission, you're looking at zero admissions on the electric railcar movers compared to an old switching locomotive. Those are the two biggest things we see when we try to convince people going from electric to a diesel, or diesel to an electric, I should say.
Absolutely. Those are great reasons and great data. Thank you very much. We're going to jump into the attendee question portion now. And I got a twofer for you, Tony. So the first question is, how much is available for Region 5?
That's a good question. I think we're about $6 million. But what I will say is that we will accept applications up to $3 million in scope. And there's no floor. So, if you're like a school system or something, if you're a small eligible entity, you can still apply.
Okay. Thank you. And the second part of that question is, are there any fuel cell technologies that are certified eligible for the upcoming solicitations as well?
Off the top of my head, I don't know them all. We have funded hydrogen fuel cell paratransit buses in Stark County, Ohio, in the past. And so electric vehicles and these sorts of vehicles aren't really certified because there's no tailpipe certification because there's no tailpipe. So it's a little bit different story with electric. But we have funded fuel cell vehicles in the past.
Okay, thank you. This question is directed at Kurt. Kurt, you had mentioned that of a 24/7 operation. How do you manage recharging for these three shift operation with the battery electric?
Yeah, it's actually it's interesting. It works out really well. So you have just there's driver breaks. The driver gets a half hour for lunch. They typically get 2 15-minute breaks. There's usually a small break between shifts, but even at just that 1 hour, an 8 hour shift, with our fast charge charging system, we can charge that truck 100% in 2 hours. So we have 3 hours during the day, if you think of the three different shifts, not even counting between shifts where one driver's getting out, one driver's getting in, usually get 20 minutes there. So you're talking about 4 hours a day to be able to recharge that when you're not planning to use the truck anyway. It would have been sitting no matter what. And so that time is plenty of time to keep these trucks up and charged and running. And so that's the beauty of it. It doesn't take that much. We've designed the system to be able to do it that way. We designed our charger system and picked the right battery and the right size so that we could make that all happen. And so it just works.
Terrific, thank you. This question is, I'll leave it open to anyone that wants to answer it, and I'll hit on it first. In the CNG, LNG infrastructure for fueling stations along major interstates and highway, is there a plan in place to incorporate some of these electric opportunities into those stations and create new DC fast charging corridors along the highways? This is something that we are beginning to see a lot more of, and we're addressing this in the I-94 Michigan to Montana grant, and to have DC fast charging stations along I-94 situated within 50 miles of each other. What I can also say is there's going to be a big I-80 project push for this as well. And I know that there are VW settlement programs that that haven't started or are starting in each of the states to address these issues. Tony or anyone else on the panel want to address this as well?
Yeah, you said it, the VW programs, there is an electric component to all of that. It is, I want to say, like $1 billion or more of that settlement. This is a multi-billion dollar settlement. And so there's a specific, very large pot of money nationwide and therefore in every state for electric charging. And again, it's the states that do run that. Those links that I put in my presentation that have the state web pages. For Wisconsin, all that's really linkable right now is their VW page. For the electric charging, you're gonna have to take a look at the link and see what they have there. fine over the diesel vehicle, and they've been sticking with VW allows them to buy just municipal and government vehicles and replace them up to 100% funding. And when the governor at the time saw that, they were like, oh, it's very easy to do that, and that's what they're doing. You know, I mean, it's a thing that they can do. But it's, you know, they're looking at their own vehicles. Other states are looking out more publicly. I know Indiana is, and I know, you know, South Shore Clean Cities folks have worked with IDEM a lot on that. I know that Illinois has some sort of public component too. You just got to be kind of, you know, on top of refreshing their webpage as well. But I'm rambling on, but yes, there is that electronic component. It's unfortunately not really through the DERA program unless you get, you know, that vehicle and you need to like plug it in. But, you know, for stations that are out there for public use, yes, explore the VW programs in each state.
All right, thank you. In consideration of time, we'll answer the questions that were submitted after the webinar. We're going to be moving on and wrapping things up here. Thank you again to all of our speakers. Thank you for sharing your expertise regarding the medium duty and heavy duty electric operations. If you would like to connect with any of these fine gentlemen after today, please find their contact information available up on the screen right now and reach out to them. And you can certainly reach out to us and we'll answer any questions or connect you with the folks that are on the webinar as well. Please be sure to contact your Clean Cities representatives if you have specific questions for each state or if you're looking to advance your fleet operations. Coming up in the near future, we want to make sure that you guys all know about a webinar coming up on Friday, January 15th. This is the Transportation Energy Partners webinar. It's from 12 to 1 p.m. Central. After that, we have the Sustainable Ports and Goods Movement webinar, and that will be on Wednesday, February 24th from 1 to 2 p.m., and that will be hosted by South Shore Clean Cities. Also, a reminder, everyone's favorite time of the year, that the annual surveys are out now for all three coalitions. Please check with each Clean Cities coalition for details and individual deadlines coming up. You can visit each of the coalition's websites for more information and to learn more about upcoming webinars and funding opportunities. Once again, just want to say thank you all again for joining us, and thank you for our speakers for taking time out of your day and participating. If there are any questions later on for our speakers, please feel free to contact them again, and we'll be happy to assist you. On behalf of Chicago Area Clean Cities, South Shore Clean Cities, and Wisconsin Clean Cities, we thank you for your time. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Be good, everybody.